the Mondavi Center at UC Davis for the wonderful medal.
It's brought the preschool back into style. Delaine, you made the civil servants all smile. Delaine, your mind is comprehensive. There's substance in your manner and your speech. You may be from San Carlos, but Davis never had a sweeter peach.
lot of friends here from college, and I not only Ginger, but Michael and Olin and Claudia, and a lot of other alums who I've met along the way. And I've got some alums from Santa Barbara who I'm thrilled are here, and that includes Mary Ann and Billy and Sally and Neil and Dave. Thank you all for coming from far and near. I have a lot of colleagues here from public and private sector lives where I've been the employee and their boss, or their boss. I have neighbors here and former board members and fellow board members now. I will say I have some people here for whom I worked, and many of them have said they taught me everything I know, and I agree completely. So Constance and Ruth and Kathy, I thank you all for what you did to teach me everything. And I want to give a shout out to the teachers who are here tonight. Preschool K-12. I would not be here tonight if it weren't for some amazing teachers. I got to UC Davis because of people like Mrs. McClaws and Ms. Holt, Mrs. Jones, Ms. Amy, Mr. McFarland, and Mr. Deck. Mr. Deck, many of you know this story. He was my drama teacher in my sophomore year. In junior, I was no longer in his class, but he cast a play. And the last day of auditions, he stopped me in the halls. He said, "May I speak to you, Ms. Easton?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Why haven't you tried out for the part of Lorraine Sheldon, the man who came to dinner?" I said, "Well, I really like you." I'm too shy. I'd probably faint at the audition. He said, "Very well, Ms. Easton, suit yourself, but this is a metaphor for your whole life. If you never try out, you will never get the part." I tried out, I got the part, and it opened a whole lot of other opportunities for me to stand and speak without fainting. I have worked with some amazing people, colleagues in Union City, in the legislature, in the Department of Education, as well as Nissel and Mills. I thank all of you who've worked for me and with me for putting your whole hearts and minds into your work. I'm a big fan of Judith Bitterman and Lauren Bennis's book, Organizing Genius. And they wrote, "Great groups are headed by people confident enough to recruit people better than themselves." And I think that's really what you got to do. Find people better than yourself to work really for you. The fact is, my hat is off to great groups and to suburb individuals who've been on various missions with me. But I do have to say to my former chief deputies, all four of whom are here tonight, to Ruth, to Richard, to Leslie, and to Scott, I thank you from the bottom of my heart. The fact is, you're always looking to do the right thing and always looking to do things right. And we did a lot. I also want to give thanks to some of my young friends who are here tonight. I've been blessed to have some inspiring students and young mentees who have lifted me up extraordinarily. As many of you know, my greatest disappointment in life was not having children. And I have been just blessed to have met and known some rock star young folks that I'm especially proud that they came this evening. So to Maha and Megan and Brenda and Daisy and Belin and Kat and Aaron and Katie and Sasha and Sarah and Jennifer and Candace and Marcus and Casey, thank you for keeping me off of this. Lastly, let me acknowledge those of you who come here from Washington State and San Diego, from Reno and San Luis Obispo, Big Sur and Monterey Peninsula, from Santa Barbara and Reno, and of course the Bay Area. People who come by bus and plane and by car. But your presence could not be more appreciated. Emily Dickinson said, "My friends are my estate. Nothing could be truer for me than that." So in addition to thanking my alma mater, I want to thank each one of you who helped me carry the load of life at times when I was faint of heart, for helping me to get great gifts like having an amazing child development center named for me in Fremont, a K-5 elementary school in Union City. The principal of Easton Elementary is here tonight. And an art gallery in Hillsburg High School. Thank you all for all you did to make that happen. I guess everybody here probably knows that my favorite movie, or maybe you don't know, is It's a Wonderful Life. And I've had a wonderful life. The reality is that it is true that sometimes my heroes were like Clarence Oddbody. You remember him? George Bailey, when he learned that Clarence was his guardian angel, he thought for a minute and says, "You look like the kind of guardian angel I get." But at times I really didn't appreciate how fortunate I was. Looking back, I realize I have traveled in the company of giants, and I feel so blessed to have made so many wonderful friends throughout my life, some of whom cannot be here because they are not with us anymore, or could not be here for a variety of reasons. But I thank you all for making the effort to be here. I will tell you that saying you pick the parents that you have the most to learn from in life, and I picked a couple of great teachers. My dad gave my brother and me a 50-cent a week allowance only if we did our chores, but we got a dollar for every poem we memorized. The reality is he knew more poetry than any person I have ever known, this machinist, and knew more poetry than any person I've ever known except some other members of his family, who also know an awful lot of poetry. His love of literature and poetry enriched my life. My mother was also an avid reader and an important influence. And when I was about 10, my mother got in an argument with her cousin Ed. We called him Uncle Ed, and he was a big shot VP for a big corporation, and he was at Gene and George's house. And he said that my parents needed to be certain that my brother went to college. They didn't have to worry about me going to college because I would get my MRS degree. I didn't need college because my husband would be able to support me. My mother responded, "Ed, I have the best husband in the world. But do you know how many women I know that are stuck in dreadful marriages because they cannot afford to support their families or themselves? Women can only make a decent income if they are educated, and then they have choices." I know now she was right. Of history and storytelling, he has been an amazing role model in my life. His acceptance at college came the year my grandfather lost the sawmill during the Great Depression. Oh, and the house burned down about that time, 1930. So my dad joined the U.S. Navy and sent money home to help his own parents and keep his brother at Eastern Kentucky University. He never got to go to college, but he often said what I said on that tape: the most important thing you can have in this world is to have an education. And so when I did get accepted to UC Davis in 1965, I was disappointed. But my mother said, "Well, Delaine, we can't really afford to send you. Dad's been on strike, we used up our savings, and oh, you know, the law says the girls can't take out the college student loans until they're 21. The boys can do it at 18. So maybe you should go to the community college." I went into my father in a very mature voice. I said, My father said, "Let's go talk to your mother." He said, "Donnie, what's this about Delaine not going to Davis?" "Well, Hank, I talked to the bank president. We'd have to borrow the money at 7.5%, pay it back in 3 years. By the time she's 21, we would owe twice our house payment on her college student loans." My father said, "We've got to find a way to send her to Davis." My mother said, "Well, what do you suggest we do? Take a second mortgage out on the house?" And my father said, and I quote, "We'll sell the goddamn house if we have to. She's going to Davis." On that day in 1969, when I graduated, you saw those pictures. My parents just were bursting their buttons. I was worried my father might hurt someone with his. The reality is that many of you know that my mother was an alcoholic, as was her mother who lived with us. The chaos that was prevalent in my house was one of the reasons that I was desperate to go away to school. I became a community college believer, as I taught there for 7 years. But the decision to go to the University of California at Davis was life-changing in my eyes, then and now. And for the life of me, I am mystified that so many people in the United States generally, and California specifically, fail to understand the amazing importance of the education of children from preschool to graduate school. The truth is, I want to take a moment and first toast real American heroes. You know, we're brought up in a society where we're taught the American heroes look like movie stars, but in my experience, they look more like Abe Lincoln or Harriet Tubman. They look like Mr. Rogers or Betty White, and Rob Reiner or Robert Jordan. They look more like Cesar Chavez than Tom Cruise, more like Dolores Huerta than Reese Witherspoon. They look like Karen O'Connor and Claudia Woods and Sari Culberg and Mary Gear and Nancy Slider and Sally Baker and Ralphine Lee and Kate Burns and Mary Allen and Daylin Malik, Helen Papadopoulos, and Jay Deck, and so many others of you that I haven't named. They look like the people in this room, the heroes. I had a chance to work with in state government who supported streamlining construction of schools and hospitals, who worked to improve transportation and fought to expand preschool and child development, who toiled to put gardens in schools and to emphasize writing as well as reading. It looked like the people that fought to improve school libraries and bring back librarians. It looked like the team that fought to make school financial oversight stronger and to improve technology and science education. They look like the people in this room that served on task forces to improve all manner of education, from preschool and arts education and special education and college readiness and STEAM and STEM. They are the people who fought to improve the social and emotional health of children. They look like those who labored to develop the finest school safety and school readiness prevention, school violence prevention plan in the United States, as the United States Secretary of Education, Dick Riley, told me. They helped us convince CSU and UC to have the same basic educational requirements for entrance. They fought to make kindergarten mandatory in full day, and that's still a fight we have to join, as well as the fight for universal preschool. And when we sponsored the first net day, the president and vice president and the whole Clinton cabinet came to California to wire our schools. Vice President Gore said to me, "Oh, the Silicon Valley doesn't have wiring, then they're not wired in Massachusetts or Montana or Mississippi. We need a national effort to improve the school's technology." And he later told me that it was because of his experience in Concord, California, that he went back and fought for the E-rate. The reality is that when I proposed reducing class size, the then governor said I was throwing money at a problem. He said there was no research to bear out the idea. Ah, but we had the research. And we had something more important. We had common sense, yes, and courage and vision and heart that was spoken of. Remember what Mark Twain said, though? The problem with common sense, it's not very common. And so when the governor finally came around, he said instead of my bill that had a 4-year phase-in that I was supporting, that we had to do this class size reduction in 2 months. We had 2 weeks to get the application out on the street. Fortunately, Ann Evans was in school construction at the time. So Pete Wilson called me into his office a few days after the bill was signed, and Ann was present. The governor said, "Sorry, we haven't given you much time, 2 weeks, and we haven't given you any staff or any money to implement this $2.3 billion program. Is there anything I can do to help?" And I said, "Well, yes, Governor, you can get the 5 state agencies that we have to report through out of our way." And he said, "Do we really have 5 state agencies?" And his staff, to her credit, said, "Don't go there, Governor. Delaine tried to eliminate 4 of them and gave them a letter." So in the end, the governor became very cooperative, and of course, he took full credit for class size reduction. But always remember that old line: don't care who gets credit. There's no end to what we can accomplish. I continue to say that we need great research institutions like my wonderful alma mater, University of California at Davis. But we also need leaders with the courage and the vision and the heart to do what the research suggests.
Most of our heroes are intelligent, but lots of intelligent people have no courage to stand up to what needs to be done to help the children who need some extra support in the short run, who will make huge contributions to our society in the long run. Most heroes are insightful, but a lot of insightful people have no heart to fight for what needs to be done to save children on the margins of life. When our research tells us clearly what we can and should do to enrich the lives of the youngest among us. Budgets in the end are statements of values, and if you looked at the California budget, you'd think our first priority was prisons. Most heroes are perhaps unsure of what strategy needs to be followed for success, but they try again and again. Sadly, lots of aware people lack the vision to take a chance on saving the lives of children who have been in dysfunctional families, in foster care, in chaotic surroundings. What's the use, say too many? Well, remember, great civilizations inspire great personal achievement and great social responsibility. Great civilizations arise from the imagination and hard work of people who are nurtured by the societies to develop their gifts. In a word, education. Education, the place where personal and social responsibility come together for personal and social greatness, both together. In a great civilization, cities, counties, schools are institutional incubators of human potential. Our job is to create institutional incubators of human potential. The journalist Richard Cohen observed, "Those with nothing to gain have nothing to lose." If you want to understand why children join gangs, engage in self-destructive behavior, drop out, get pregnant in their early teens, vandalize or self-destruct, please remember how very costly it is to have a generation of children with nothing to lose. The poet Nietzsche said it so beautifully. He who has a why to live can bear with almost any how. When Viktor Frankl was asked how he survived the concentration camp during the Holocaust, he said, "He who has a why to live can bear with almost any how." So my last point to remember is to lend a hand to support education from preschool to graduate school. If I had a wish, I would wish that preschools and child development would be joined at the hip with K-12, and that they would stand shoulder to shoulder with community colleges, state universities, and the University of California. For heaven's sakes, if I gave the strongest person in this room, well, if I gave each of you 24 pencils, one at a time, you could all break them. But not the strongest person in this room, and don't you try this, Marcus, could break 24 pencils if they were together. We need to put education together and fight for one another and not with one another. Preschool should not take from K-12, nor should we let higher education be put in competition with child development and elementary and secondary education. In the words of Gary Snyder, who was a former medal recipient and a great poet, he wrote in a poem, "To climb these coming crests, one word to you, you and your children, stay together, learn the flowers, go light." Please remember this is important that we stay together. And that's true in education, in friendship, in families, in neighborhoods, in communities, in states, and in nations. We need to stay together for what is right. Let me say that in the darkest days of my life, when I was uncertain, one or more of you stepped up to remind me of why. I have been able to bear with many pains and disappointments because so many of you gave me a why. And you stood with me. I hope that I will never forget your support. If I leave you with one last thought from me, it is thank you. From the bottom of my heart, for opening doors and yes, giving me a shoulder to cry on, holding my hand and lifting me up, yes, for writing me letters of reference or even writing checks for my campaign, making me laugh so hard that I snorted in an unladylike fashion. You walked 3/6 and provided Kleenex. You helped me find the right clothes to wear and helped improve my appearance. Sometimes taking me to lunch or dropping me a line or making sure that my house and home were supported when I was traveling. I am forever grateful. Again, my thanks to my alma mater for what is for me the highest honor I have ever dared to dream. In the words of E. Cummings, I thank you, God, for most this amazing day, for the leaping greenly spirits of trees and a blue true dream of sky, and for everything which is natural, which is infinite, which is yes. I who have died am alive again today, and this is the sun's birthday. This is the birthday of life and of love and wings and of the gay, great, happening, illimitable earth. I am glad that I have lived to see this day and night. And all of you, thank you, and go Aggs.
After Delaine. I think we all agree she not only is a woman of courage, vision, and heart, but one of our nation's best speakers. Delaine. Our time together draws to a close, and we want to give special thanks to the Doug Polly Trio for the music played. And UC Davis were selecting Delaine Eastin for the Medal of Honor. And to Delaine herself for inspiring us all. Delaine.